Welcome everyone to the ER Online Summer Seminars. I'm very happy to host this event together with Enrico Franconi. So this idea was, if you please check our website here, we're gonna have a full program that starts now. So this the idea of this summer seminar started as a summer school, actually, in the tradition of the International Conference on Conceptual Modeling that goes back four decades. We wanted to organize the first ER summer school in the scope of this event called the Summer of Knowledge that we wanted to host in Bolzano as a series of almost 20 events in the city of Bolzano in South Tyrol, in north of Italy. As you all know, we had to change our plans with everything which we are experiencing now. The event BOSC, the Bolzano Summer of Knowledge, is still happening, half of the events now online and some of these events next year. We hope we'll be back to some sense of normality next year, and hope to welcome in Bolzano. Again, this is connected to to this event, the Bolzano Summer of Knowledge, but also to the ER conference. So this series of talks with world-class figures in the areas of conceptual modeling, knowledge representation, AI, will go from now, starting today with this inaugural lecture, until the week before ER 2020 in Vienna, in Austria, which is the first week of November. So I welcome, I invite you also to check the conference webpage. Formal semantics of current knowledge representation languages usually account for a set of models which is much larger than the models we are interested in, that is, real-world models. As a consequence, the possibility to state something which is reasonable for the system but not reasonable in the real world is very high. What we need instead is a semantics which is not neutral with respect to some basic ontological assumptions. This is amazing even when I read it nowadays, and it's even more amazing when I think that this was written by our guest today 30 years ago in a paper in 1991. So I'm very happy to have in this inaugural lecture Nicola Guarino. Nicola is one of the founding fathers of ontologies in computer science. He has these three decades trying to take a number of things from philosophy, from analytic philosophy, from formal ontology, from cognitive science and linguistics, and build a bridge to many areas in computer science. Again, knowledge representation and conceptual modeling, for example. Nicola is very well known for his contribution. He is one of the authors of the OntoClean methodology, perhaps the first methodology for ontology engineering, and for the Deutsche Foundation Ontology. He was the founder of the International Association for Ontologies and its Applications, and for the the Applied Ontology Journal. He was the editor-in-chief for the Applied Ontology Journal for many, many years. And I'm very happy to have him today. So I would invite Nicola to, floor is yours, and I would like to invite him to tell us why we should break with neutral ontological assumptions and how to do that.
Okay, hello everybody. It's a pleasure and an honor to start this series of online seminars on conceptual modeling. And thanks very much to Enrico and Giancarlo for the invitation. In this introductory talk, I will try to illustrate both why ontological analysis is important and how it can be exploited in the actual modeling practice. Consider a data pattern. Of course, we are exposed to tons of data patterns, and data analytics is popular nowadays. What is this pattern about? Is it about the current pandemic, maybe? No. It is an ECG signal. Indeed, we can collect more data about like this, but to understand and use them, data analytics is not enough. Indeed, the meaning of this data can only be understood in association with knowledge about the structure and the behavior of things in the real world. So, paraphrasing Kant, we can say that concepts without data are empty, while data without concepts are blind. So we need both, basically. So concepts are important to interpret data. Okay, this is an obvious message. But how are concepts related to the world? According to Plato, good concepts are those that reflect the intrinsic nature of the world, so that they, he said, carve reality at its joints. So in Plato's metaphor, good concepts are like good cuts of meat, so to speak, okay, that follow the natural joints of bones and tendons. And so a good philosopher for Plato is like a good butcher. This is his metaphor. Unfortunately, however, even presenting the joints, preserving the joints, the natural joints of reality, communication problems may arise. Indeed, this is because people may make different assumptions about the proper boundaries of meat cuts, and also because they use different names for them. Now, people's assumptions about reality are exactly the subject matter of applied ontology, which is now an emerging interdisciplinary area. It builds on philosophy, cognitive science, linguistics, and logic with the purpose of understanding, clarifying, making explicit, and communicating people's assumptions about the nature and the structure of the world. And this orientation towards ultimately helping people understanding each other distinguishes applied ontology from philosophical ontology and motivates its unavoidable interdisciplinary nature. Ontological analysis can be defined as the study of the content of these assumptions, taken as such, independently of their representation. The content as such. And computational ontologies are artifacts that specify the content of these assumptions in a machine readable form in terms of primitive categories and relations, general notions borrowed from philosophy, which describe the nature and structure of a particular domain of discourse. This is my favorite definition of a computational ontology. You may be familiar with the simpler definition by Tom Gruber in 93. He defined computational ontologies as explicit and formal specification of a conceptualization. This is okay, this is not in conflict with the definition I gave. We also only have to be careful about the meaning of conceptualization, as we shall see. In any case, computational ontologies, in the way they evolved, unavoidably mixed together philosophical, cognitive, and linguistic aspects. And my message is that ignoring this intrinsic interdisciplinary nature makes these ontologies are almost useless. Another way of seeing computational ontologies is thinking of them as fine prints, like a contrast fine print, one of those ad hoc glossaries that clarify the way certain terms are used within a contract. Okay. Typically, people ignore these fine prints, but in critical situations, they can save a business. Indeed, ontologies have a contractual nature. Depending on how carefully they are designed, serious consequences may occur. And a stunning example of the importance of carefully designed ontologies comes from the case of the Twin Tower disaster. There was a single leaseholder, the owner of the two buildings, and the two buildings were, of course, insured against disasters, each of them. And the insurance value for a disaster event was $3.5 billion. And Mr. Silberstein, who was the leaseholder, was claiming, therefore, about $7 billion because he was claiming there have been two events. But after a trial, the judge ruled that on the basis of the insurance form actually signed, it was only one disaster event, since the two crashes were considered as a part of a single criminal design. So there was a $3 billion question. One event or two? And this is a classic ontological question, whose answer indeed depends on the way your particular ontological commitments about events is made explicit. In this case, the insurance company was careful enough in defining occurrence, okay, disastrous occurrence in a way which was convenient for them. So this story is illuminating, because actually this was a matter of how careful a particular ontological commitment is made explicit. Now, this is enough for the motivations for computational ontologies. Let's see what they are in practice. This reality, okay? There are phenomena occurring in reality, different kinds of phenomena, those that are studied by physicists, biologists, astronomers, and so on. Through time, we are exposed to multiple experiences of such realities, which presents to our senses via multiple presentation patterns. And from these patterns, we have relevant invariants, isolating those things which are cognitively relevant for us, which are the elements of the cognitive domain, D, as well as the properties and the relations that are useful to organize them. This is the set with the symbol R, okay? D is the set of cognitive cognitive relevant entities, and R is the set of properties and relations we use to organize them. Okay? All these things are conceptualized, are in our mind, and are the result of being exposed to reality, possibly also in genetic sense, in an evolution sense. Now, when we want to talk about this conceptualization, to communicate relevant things, relevant information about the things which are relevant for you, you have to use a certain language. Suppose it is a logical language, it typically is natural language, but in a way, we need a language to talk about these things, the elements of D organized according to the elements of R. And so this language has to commit to this conceptualization. And this commitment consists in a choice with respect to the actual subset of D, which is relevant, which contains the things we want to talk about. So this D prime is the domain of discourse, and R prime is the set of relevant properties and relations which will ultimately determine the signature of our language. Now, if this language is interpreted by another person, by different from the one who has the original conceptualization, of course, a number of possible interpretations are open. The problem is making sure that indeed the intended models are those which are understood. I'm using models and interpretation in the usual logical sense. These are Tarskian interpretations of a logical language. Now, an ontology can be seen as a set of formulas which written in this language, which constrain the possible interpretations. So, to guarantee the fact that the actual interpretation as the intended one, we can start writing sentences in the language L, which are actually meaning postulates, which taken together logically restrict the possible interpretations, resulting in a set of admitted interpretations, which should be as close as possible to the set of the intended ones. And of course, if we do things not properly, we can result in a bad ontology. A bad ontology is a set of meaning postulates which does not reflect the intended models. This is the general picture which shows how computational ontologies are connected with reality through cognition. And the important point to understand is the difference between the intended models and the set of admitted interpretations. Okay, the intended models are in yellow, the admitted models are in red. Depending on how these two sets are related to each other, different conclusions can be made concerning the quality of the ontology. An ontology can be more or less precise if it captures the intended models, but still also allows a number of non-intended models. Why this notion of precision is important? Consider a term, an ambiguous term like service. Giancarlo and I have done a lot of work on services, and we realized how ambiguous, how polysemic this word is in practice. Now, suppose there is an agent according to whom the service is interpreted basically as a commitment to do things. And for another agent, service is interpreted as an action. A service is an action, okay? So these two intended interpretations are disjoint, okay? They selected disjoint subset of from the set of all possible interpretations. But now suppose that the agent A adopts a lightweight ontology, a very imprecise ontology, which allows for lots of interpretations which are different from the intended ones, although also covering the intended ones. And the same for agent B, okay? They are both adopting lightweight ontologies which do not capture exactly the intended meaning. What may happen is that since the two sets of admissible interpretations are very large, they may easily overlap, as in this case, okay? So that we may logically conclude that there are common interpretations. So we can conclude that there is some basis for interoperability. But such interpretations are not intended by anyone, are not intended by agent A and not intended by agent B. The problem is that the two agents may believe they can get an agreement while actually they are not agreeing at all about these models. And this may result in disasters. This is an example which shows why precision is important. Anyway, precision may be not enough. Consider suppose we want to build a little ontology, a tiny ontology, clarifying the intended interpretation of a single predicate on, being on, for instance, for a block to be on something. Okay, suppose, for instance, we have three blocks in our domain. We start writing axioms. We easily come up with some axiom which says that on is asymmetric and anti-transitive. Okay, these are obvious, more or less, to capture, to exclude non-intended models. For instance, a model where A is on itself, or a model where in the figure B is on C, C is on A, and B is also on A. Okay, fine. So we can, indeed, we can ask ourselves whether we need extra axioms, but with this tiny choice, simple choice of the domain, and with this simple choice of the language, which only contains one predicate, we cannot indeed figure out any important axiom to capture the meaning of on. But still, there are real-world situations which cannot be distinguished by means of this axiomatization. The axiomatization is precise because it excludes non-intended models, but still it is not accurate enough to exclude, to distinguish the case where, you know, the two blocks are in contact with one each other from the case where there is a special gap between them. So the message is that in some cases, even if you exclude non-intended models, still you are not able to actually reflect the different cases in reality you want to distinguish. The reason for this is in the difference between the logical notion of model and the ontological notion of actual situations in reality. In order to come up with a more accurate ontology, which reflects and which is capable to explain to somebody what does it mean for a block to be on another block, we need either to introduce other entities in our domain of discourse, for instance, region of space, which may be empty or not, okay? Or introduce other primitives in our language, for instance, some notion of connection, which tells us whether the two blocks are topologically connected or not. So capturing all intended models is not sufficient for a perfect ontology. So we have two quality dimensions, so to speak, and a dimension of precision, which is related to the fact of whether or not non-intended models are excluded, and the dimension of accuracy, which is related to whether or not actual, real counterexamples are excluded. A good ontology should be both precise and accurate. You may ask, but why is this really needed? Okay. Well, the benefits of adopting a precise and accurate ontology are not only those of achieving a common agreement, but even more importantly, making explicit and understanding the reasons of disagreement. If there is a disagreement, what's important is to understand why, in order to possibly afford the obstacles to interoperability. Okay. This is enough for the answer to the question why ontologies are useful. Let's now enter into the realm of how. Okay, how can we actually build good ontologies? What are the tools we can use for building good ontologies? And these tools unavoidably come from philosophy, in particular from analytic philosophy. This is a picture of Aristotle from the Raffaello's Athene school's painting in La Cappella Sistina, And Chris Welty, long time ago, when visiting our center, had the idea of putting in the hands of Aristotle a computer just to symbolize the idea of this fertile mix-up between philosophy and computer science. And from philosophy, we can borrow the principles for formal ontological analysis. The theory of parts, the theory of unity and plurality, essence, identity, dependence, composition, constitution, properties, qualities. For each of these topics, there are tons of publications. We can borrow results from philosophy, building on the basis of these tools, the basis of a common ontology vocabulary. The important aspect of this theories which come from, which have been studied in philosophy, is their generality. Okay, they are really, really general. So we can hope, we can build specific concepts on top of them, exactly in the same way, a mathematician, okay, builds his own specific theory from building blocks like the notion of number, the notion of set, the notion of function, and so on. Okay, we need this general notion to ground our theory. And formal ontology can be defined as the theory of formal distinctions and connections within entities on the world, as we perceive them, so-called particulars, and categories we used to talk about them, so-called universals. Why formal? Just a clarification, why formal? Formal, well, we can compare formal logic with formal ontology. This is an idea by Husserl. Formal logic is about connections between truths. Okay, formal logic is neutral with respect to truth. Okay. Similarly, formal ontology is about connections between things. This talk exists, for instance, somebody must all exist, like me, okay, because the talk cannot exist without somebody which participates to the talk. Okay. So, and formal ontology is about connection between things, and it is neutral with respect to reality. Logic is neutral with respect to truth. Formal ontology is neutral with respect to reality. So, formal has two meanings, okay? This meaning, which is general, as a synonym of general, and also as a synonym of rigorous. And when I say formal ontology, I don't simply say that it is represented in a formal language. This is not enough. And maybe to avoid confusions, maybe analytic ontology may be a better term. Now, these formal notions, these formal ontological notions, have a double role in conceptual modeling. On one hand, they can help us in clarifying and making explicit the ontological nature of basic modeling constructs. Okay. So this means that the constructs, the modeling constructs, are specified at the ontological level. Okay. Examples are the ontoclean methodology and the onto-UML language developed by Giancarlo, which, and I will give some examples about this later on. The second role of formal ontological analysis in conceptual modeling concerns its role in clarifying and making explicit the nature of the domain of discourse. Basically, these general ontological principles may help us in providing guidelines for reification choices, which are of huge importance in the actual practice of conceptual modeling, deciding what to reify, what to put in your domain of discourse. And they also may help providing modeling patterns that allow to express relevant constraints on the domain. So you see these two dimensions. The first dimension, the first role of formal ontology concerns the modeling construct themselves. The second role concerns the way we use these modeling constructs to actually build a constrain a domain of discourse. Let us consider the first role, okay? Constraining modeling constructs. Suppose that you want to define the class of red apples in UML or entity relationship. So you can take red to the left. You see that the obvious choice could be to take red as a property of apples. But maybe an alternative is to devise a class which is the class of red things qualified by the property of being an apple. Okay, so this to the left you have the red things which are apples. To the right you have the red things which are apples. To the left you have the apples that are red. What is better? It seems I hope you may agree with me that the model to the left seems to be more natural, but why does the second choice sound weird? Indeed, ontological analysis helps giving an answer to this question. Okay. And the answer is in the difference between types or classes of different ontological kinds. There are sortal types and non-sortal types. Non-sortals, like being red, the type red, only carry some principle for application for their instances, so criteria for deciding whether something is actually red or not. Okay, these are principles of applications. But on the other hand, the sortal types carry both a principle of application and a principle of identity. They provide us criteria for deciding whether a certain student is entering in my office today is the same student I saw yesterday. Okay, criteria for identity criteria are provided by sortals, while non-sortals do not provide this identity criteria. So on the basis of this distinction, Ontoclean proposed to introduce a meta property, okay, plus denoted with the symbol plus I, which marks this ontological difference. And as a consequence, the consequence of this distinction also introduces taxonomic constraints in our model. This is an important practical consequence. It is not just a theoretic distinction, the one between sortals and non-sortals. As a consequence, you cannot say that that the class of insured item is a subclass of persons, because the insured item as such has no principle of identity, so it cannot inherit the principle of identities of person. This is a better model, okay? You see, there is the identity of person, the criteria of identity of persons, which are inherited by insured person and by heavy person, fine. And they, in turn, they are subclasses of insured item on one hand and heavy entity on the other hand. Okay. This is a simple example which shows how philosophical notions like criterion of identity impact the actual modeling practice. According to the Ontoclean methodology, further distinctions among sortals can be based on another formal ontological notion, namely rigidity. I will be quick on this. A rigid property is one which is necessarily shared by all instances. Okay, every person is necessarily a person, while not every student is necessarily such. A class, like student, in addition, exhibits a property which is called anti-rigidity. Okay, not only it is not the case that a student is necessarily such, but none of the instances of student is necessarily an instance of that class. Okay, none of the instance is necessarily an instance of the class. So this is the property which is called anti-rigidity. Okay, student, teenager, all these are examples of classes which carry this anti-rigidity meta-property. And anti-rigidity is useful to define an important class of constructs which are roles. Roles are not only anti-rigid, but also externally dependent. A type is externally dependent if its definition involves another property such that for every instance of the type, there is an instance of this property which is external to the instance itself. Okay, you can read it yourself. So the example, again, in the case of student, a student cannot exist unless something else different from it, from him or her, exists. Okay, a student, the notion of student is defined, is a relative notion, which be defined with either with respect to a school or possibly with respect to a subject matter or a teacher and so on. But the point is that a student is never alone. It is a relative notion. Okay. And roles are defined as classes which are both anti-rigid and externally dependent. The practical consequence of this definition, again, is a constraint on the models. Okay, the cardinality, you know, the minimal cardinality attached to school in this example cannot be zero. Okay, necessarily for every student, there must be at least one school if a student is considered as a role. A further example of a constraint which comes from the distinction between roles and so-called kinds, which are those types which are rigid and are not roles, okay, is that a class, the class of customer cannot subsume the class of persons, okay? It is just a logical consequence. If customer is anti-rigid, then since person is rigid, instances of persons cannot be customers. So you see how ontological analysis constrains the modeling language. Let us consider now the second role of ontological analysis characterizing the domain of discourse. Okay. Indeed, I have been pretty quick in these examples about OntoClean and OntoUML, also because this is established work, and maybe many of you have seen these things already. For the rest of the talk, I would like to concentrate on more recent results, which concern indeed this second role of ontological analysis in characterizing the domain of discourse. So, the point is is very much related with the notion of reification. Remember when I introduced the relationship between a conceptualization and the language, I said that the language has to commit to a subset of the cognitive domain, so-called domain of discourse. The domain of discourse, the things we want to talk, okay, is typically much smaller than all possible relevant things. Okay, there are relevant things that you may not be able to talk, okay, or you inadvertently forget to talk, to introduce in the domain of discourse. So indeed, when a property or a relation holds, sometimes it presupposes some hidden entities we can talk of unless we put them in the domain of discourse. For instance, typical examples, if I want to talk of Mary's beauty, okay, if I say Mary is beautiful, but if I want to talk of Mary's beauty, I have to reify something. I have to reify a quality. If I say the marriage lasted 2 years, I have to reify events. If I say the relationship with my boss was very difficult and so on, I have to reify relationships. Okay. Reification is the act of putting in the domain of discourse an entity otherwise hidden, although presupposed by the language. And the question is, the practical question every modeler, every conceptual modeler has to address is, what to reify? There is an ontological answer to that, a general answer to that. Reify those entities that are responsible for the truth of your positions. So these entities, which are responsible for the truth of our propositions, are called truth makers in analytic philosophy. So we can see ontological analysis as a search for truth makers, like a detective lens. And the questions are maybe similar to the classic the detective questions: what, why, where, and so on. What makes our statements about the world true? When, where is this true, and so on? In other words, how do we believe the world is when we say things like, this rose is red, John is married with Mary? This road is red because of something occurring in the rose. Well, not because of its weight, but because of its color. So I have to recognize an entity which is called the color of the rose in order to justify why this sentence is true. Similarly, if I ask myself why, what makes it true that John is married with Mary, it is typically because of an event which occurred many years ago, okay, when they promised one each other, they made a certain kind of promise. Or maybe also because of the actual commitments John has towards Mary and vice versa, and agreements and so on, and mutual love and so on. When I say my name is Nicola, okay, this is true not because of some particular intrinsic property of me. It is true only because many, many years ago, my parents did something. They decided to go to the municipality and to declare this was my name, okay? So recognizing these events may be important if we really want to build well-founded conceptual models. Ontological analysis is all about making this, recognizing these truth makers and making them explicit, okay? Which, by the way, I anticipated, doesn't necessarily mean that you always have to put these things explicitly, but it's important to be aware of them. There are different two main kinds of truth makers, so-called strong truth makers and weak truth makers. The truth maker of a property P holding for a certain X is a suitable Y in virtue of X of which P of X holds. Okay, this is the typical statement. Of course, the problem is understanding the meaning of in virtue of, and there are different positions. I will be brief about this. There is a debate, ongoing debate. The standard answer to this question is the following. In virtue of X means in virtue of the existence of Y. In virtue of Y means in virtue of the existence of Y. So the fact that A is a rose holds in virtue of the existence of a certain rose denoted by A. Okay. If A exists, it is a rose. If this particular rose exists, then the statement that A is a rose is true. This is trivial. On the other hand, if A is red, the truth of this statement, okay, relies not so much in the existence of A, but in the existence of a certain I would say redness event or redness state, okay? Because A may be red today and brown tomorrow, okay? So the existence of A is not enough to conclude that, to justify the truth of the proposition that A is red. So strong truth makers are those things whose mere existence entails the proposition's truth. And from the two examples, you can see that important distinctions among different properties, like being a rose and being red, can be made according to the nature of their truth makers. Weak truth making is different. According to the idea of weak truth making, a proposition holds in virtue of the way something is, not in virtue of whether something exists, but in virtue of how something is. Consider a rose, a particular rose, rose 1, which is red at time t1. The same rose is brown at time t2. The strong truth makers are different, okay? Because on one hand there is a state of being red, on the other hand there is which holds at time t1, and the state of being brown, which holds at time t2. Two different strong truth makers. The weak truth maker is the same. It is the rose itself, because of the way it is, that is red at time t1 and brown at time t2. The responsible, so to speak, of these two facts is the same guy, okay? It is rose 1. This is the idea of weak truth makers, which is due, by the way, to the work of a young philosopher who unfortunately died prematurely. Consider again the rose, okay? We may ask ourselves what is the minimal weak truth maker of the statement this rose is red. Indeed, the minimal thing which is responsible for the fact that the rose is red is the rose's corolla, or more exactly, the color of the corolla. It is because of the color of the corolla and not because of the shape of the corolla that the rose is red. So both the rose, its corolla, and the color of its corolla are all weak tooth makers. The corolla's color is, however, the minimal one. So I cannot falsify the proposition that this rose is red without a change in this individual quality, which is the color of the rose. And here enters an important notion, which is the notion of individual quality. Some properties hold in virtue of what things are, okay, in virtue of the mere existence of certain entities. Okay, person holds in virtue of what, John is a person in virtue of what it is, what he is. Other properties hold in virtue of how things are. Okay, John is in a certain way. And this is the way John is responsible for the fact that John is tall. So-called descriptive properties are properties like being tall, which differently from properties like being a person, they are about a certain aspect of an individual. Person is not about an aspect of the individual, it is about the individual as a whole. Tall, on the other hand, says something about a particular aspect of an individual, namely its height. And this aspect is something which can allow a comparison with another individual. I can compare John with let's say, a chair, okay, two very different things on the basis of their height, okay? The height allows a comparison with the individuals which are of different kinds. So such comparable aspects of individuals are what we call individual qualities, or just qualities. The height of John is an individual quality. And individual qualities are the minimal weak truth makers of descriptive properties, which hold in virtue of how things are. So individual qualities are aspects of things, okay? The rose can be compared with the chair, with the sofa, on the basis of this color, okay? There are specific aspects of things we use to compare them. They inhere in specific individuals, and they are distinct from their values, okay? The value of the color of the rose is a particular shade of red. And the values are organized in quality spaces. This is a long story, I have necessarily to be short. At different times, qualities may have different values. And it's very, despite the linguistic similarities and despite the actual English practice, properties and qualities are very different terms. Properties are universals. Properties correspond to predicates. Qualities exist. Qualities are things, elements of the domain. They are not predicable of anything. Thanks to the distinction between strong and weak truth makers, on one hand, and the notion of individual quality, on the other hand, we can open up a number of reification options for actually including individual qualities, which are weak truth makers, in a conceptual model. Or not. Okay, so a number of options. These notions introduce a number of options we may want to explore and which is useful to explore. Example, we can have different truth-making patterns for color properties. The first choice, if I want to talk of the color of roses, okay, is just to introduce the kind rows, a class rows, which is a kind because it is rigid, it is a sorter, and so on. Okay, with an attribute which is the color attribute. This is the simple choice. But this this is already a pattern. This is an option already for my modeling purposes. On the other hand, this choice A, doesn't allow me to say things like Mary likes the color of the rose. Okay. To say things like this, I have to reify the color quality. What Mary likes is a particular instance of the quality which is the color, which is of the kind color, okay, and which actually inheres in the rose. So I, in this case, if I want to talk of the fact that Mary likes the color of the rose, then I have to adopt pattern B. This is a weak truth making pattern. Okay, the weak truth maker is part of the pattern, and the pattern accounts for how the property of being red. Or any color indeed holds. On the other hand, if I want to say how long the rose was red, has been red, I need to introduce an event. And the event itself is a strong truth maker, is something whose very existence justifies the truth of a particular statement. And the relation between the rose and the event is a participation notion, while the relation between the color and the rose is an inherence notion. You see, there are three different patterns, one with no truth makers, the other one with just with the weak truth maker, and the third with the strong truth maker. And of course, I can put everything together. This is the most complete pattern. This allows me to say everything about the what's actually happening. Okay. So there is a quality, there is an event, the rose participates in the event, the quality inheres in the rose, and indeed there is another relation between colors, the color and the event, which we call the focus, but I don't have time to talk of it. I will just say that we see events as manifestations of the qualities. I see I have 5 minutes. I more or less. We have seen the relevance of applying. Ontological analysis to properties, distinguishing among very different kinds of properties, and reifying properties by means of qualities and so on. The same analysis can be done for relationships. Sometimes we must put relationships in our domain of discourse. Okay? Arguably, these two people are talking of their own relationship. So reifying relationships has a number of advantages, since we can talk of the way relationships change in time, their interaction with the world, and so on. Together with Giancarlo and Tiago Sales and others, we have done substantive work recently on this idea. Just a clarification, relationships are not tuples, okay? They are what binds the elements of a tuple together, okay? The notion of relationship is an ontological notion, it's not a mathematical notion. And indeed, the problem of relationships has been already studied, and modeling relationship has been already studied by Giancarlo in his PhD thesis when he considered the example for instance, of the relationship between a patient and the medical unit, which is typically modeled as a many-to-many relationship. But in order to distinguish between different cases, for instance, a personal treatment, a couple treatment, you realize that the cardinality constraints do not work, are not enough. So Giancarlo's solution was to introduce the notion of relator, okay? Something which glues together the patient with the medical unit. In these ways, you can have a personal treatment which exactly involves one patient and a medical unit, and a couple treatment which involves a medical unit and exactly two patients. What we did recently, this was originally already in Giancarlo's thesis, was to try to answer the question, what is actually the nature of a relationship? Giancarlo was postulating already the importance of reifying them in order to solve cardinality constraints. Well, take the relationship between John and Mary. What is it? It is basically the sum of their mutual loves, the love of John has towards Mary is a quality, so to speak, in hearing in John. The love Mary has toward John is a quality as well. The sum of the two things is the relationship between them. When they talk of a relationship, they are actually talking of these qualities. So once we realize, similarly, for instance, the height relationship between them is a sum of qualities, the sum of the height of John plus the height of Mary. Let me just give you the idea of applying these distinctions in the practical examples of conceptual modeling. We first, on the basis of the different truth makers, we first distinguish between descriptive relations and non-descriptive relations. Description relations, similarly to descriptive properties, hold in virtue of how the arguments are. Non-descriptive relations hold in virtue of what the arguments are. And there are also another distinction, relevant distinction, which I will be silent of. The point is that at the end of the day, we on the basis of these formal notions, we organize the different kind of relations in different classes, okay? Based on the distinction, descriptive, non-descriptive, and internal, external. And we come up with different modeling patterns for the different kinds of relations. These are the modeling patterns for comparative relations, okay? Again, I can omit including weak truth makers, or, and this is the case A, in the case B, I can only put the weak truth makers, okay? In the case C, I also add the strong truth maker, the event of weight imbalance. And they can do the same things also for more complicated relations. This is the most complicated case, a contractual relationship, which has different parts, which is a claim, a commitment, which is the focus of an event, which is the contract evolution, and so on. I have to conclude. Just pointing to the fact that this idea of reify relationships, so-called relators, is extremely powerful. You can also have relationships of relationships, like in the case of compliance, for instance. Conclusion. I have seen how ontological analysis helps in the conceptual modeling in two ways, by constraining the domain, the primitives, and by constraining the domain. We can ask ourselves whether a new discipline of modeling and applied ontology is emerging. Maybe, and indeed there are signs that justify this position according to somebody. People talk of web science, service science, data science. Maybe ontological analysis and applied ontologies can be seen in this way. I don't know. For sure, a humble interdisciplinary approach is needed, focusing on promoting mutual cross-fertilization of different disciplines. An interdisciplinary approach in this endeavor is absolutely fundamental. And I conclude here.